Okay, so our next presenter is José Antonio Torrizada, in the branch of Ecoregum. He studies at Universidad Peruana de Cayetano Heredia. He's actually working in the University of Missouri Center. And the talk of today is entitled Disease Ecology in Galápagos and Perspective on Mosquitoes. So let's give him a warm welcome, please.
Thank you, Gustavo, for the presentation. As he mentioned, I'm José Antonio Torrizada. I'm from the branch of Ecorepu. I'm doing an internship at the Barker Lab at the University of Missouri St. Louis. And I'm going to present you about disease ecology in Galapagos, a perspective on mosquitoes. The PhD candidate I'm working with is Samoa Abasigao, and the PI of the lab is Dr. Patricia Parker. Just to give you a brief background of the information, what my PI does, she's an animal behaviorist. She started doing animal behavior in birds in Galapagos, and then she wanted to take a step further and start thinking on how some diseases affect bird populations and give more information about this. So here is a picture. It's not the entire lab. Actually, this is a picture from last week with some visitors from the Galapagos. There is my PI, Dr. Patricia Parker. There is Samoa, the PhD candidate I'm working with. And there is me. That's the only picture I have with me from the lab. So, how did it all started with avian malaria? So, avian malaria was first documented in 2009 in the Galapagos archipelago on the endemic species of the Galapagos pinguin, the species Spanisus mendigus, via PCR. This was reported in this paper that my PI collaborated in. And some years later, she published this one of multiple lineages of avian malaria parasites transmitted in the Galapagos Island, an evidence for arrival via migratory birds. In this paper, they identified three lineages of Plasmodium. They detected lineage A that was present across all the area sample, and lineage B and C vary within years and within locations. So why is it important to study avian malaria? Here's a graph. So first of all, it can lead to a species extinction, and it's also very important to know the stage of the parasite to know how it will evolve. What's the stage of the parasite? So first, for you to understand more about avian malaria, we have a mosquito, number one. This mosquito takes a plasmid from this bird that we call bird number one. This mosquito has the plasmodium and it infects the bird. This bird, inside the bird, the plasmodium starts to continue its life cycle and changes into the gametocyte stage, which is this one right here. This stage is the most infection stage of the parasite. In this stage, it means that the parasite has entered to the red blood cell. Then what happens? Then comes another mosquito, mosquito number two. This mosquito takes a plasmid from bird number one and passes it to another bird, bird number two. This is how avian malaria is transmitted between species. It's also very important to know how avian malaria is in the species, because there's a case in the Hawaiian Islands that when avian malaria arrived, it led to extinction of some endemic species of the islands. So what we have in Galapagos? Well, in Galapagos we have three mosquitoes. Two Culex quinquefasciatus and Aedes aegypti that arrived recently to the archipelago. And then we have Aedes tinerificus, which is like the, let's say, like the local mosquito of Galapagos that arrived around 200,000 years ago. Here are some pictures. Culex quinquefasciatus, Aedes aegypti, and Aedes tinerificus. What are the research questions Samoa is trying to assess in this project? First, she is wondering
what are the natural host parasite associations in which these mosquitoes could be involved.
This is the most crucial stage of the research because this will tell us if the Plasmodium is present on the mosquito samples, and with that we can assess different questions. Ask question number two,
that is, what are the feeding preference for Culex pinguifaciatus and Aedes cinerinos?
In this case, Aedes aegypti was not considered because the sampling size was too low. So, knowing the feeding preference of these two species of mosquitoes could help future studies and future ways to help assess, help control the rate of transmission between species in the Galapagos archipelago. Where was the sampling, sir? This was all done before my arrival to the lab.
Here is a map of the Galapagos archipelago,
the sampling site in the Santa Cruz Island,
and this is an actual photo of Samoa's workstation. She had 9 stations across Santa Cruz Island with double sampling in each station.
What were her sampling methods?
She used light traps, like this one.
These type of traps simulate emit CO2 and then simulate a vertebrate host, so it helps attract host-seeking mosquitoes.
And then rabbit traps.
These type of traps are for oviposting mosquitoes.
Then, when she collected the mosquitoes, she used a sterile scalpel, as you can see here, it's not a picture from her,
to separate the abdomen from the head and thorax. The abdomen were also separated. She found blood meals and the abdomen was engorged. When the abdomen is engorged, you can actually see it like it's enlarged and it's red. So she separated those.
Head and thorax was preserved in lysis preservative, and the whole mosquitoes in preserved in
95% ether. So what I've been doing in the lab, for the time I've been doing this internship since Greco started, I've been helping Samoa identify if the Plasmodium was present or not in the mosquitoes. So these are, well, how do I do it? First of all, we run the nested PCR to identify the presence of Plasmodium
using Waldenstrom reaction. That was tried by Waldenstrom
and collaborators from
2004.
What is a nested PCR? Nested PCR consists
on two reactions. First, we use outer primers that target
and bigger size of the RM beacon. And then we run a second PCR using inner primers,
and these targets
your RM beacon. Doing two PCRs using these two types of primers increase the resolution and the abundance of the RM beacon at the end.
This is an actual picture of the outer primers we're using in the lab, and these are the inner primers.
For this, we use both the DNA extracted from the head and thorax and the abdomen from the mosquitoes. What are the results I'm getting so far?
Well, I sampled 230 samples out of 1100, and I've only got 9 positives, like this one that was the first deal I ran in the lab.
This was kind of exciting because samples of mosquitoes from the previous year, they were not getting the Plasmodium and they were thinking that it was not there.
So these 9
positives that I got are from 2 whole mosquitoes,
and the other 5 are from
either head and thorax or abdomen,
and they are from these 2 stations.
These mosquitoes are saved and are going to be sequenced in the following weeks. Then what I will be doing when I go back the remaining time I have at AMFO,
we'll be helping with this. What are the breeding preference for Culex pinguifaciatus?
For this, the prediction is that the mosquitoes will show a preference for certain taxa.
Culex pinguifaciatus will show a preference for birds.
Aedes cinerinos will favor reptiles and mammals,
and Aedes aegypti will favor humans.
This prediction of AS inter-windows, we got it from this paper that was from Batal and collaborators from 2012. On this paper, they focus on AS inter-windows. They identified millions of reptiles, birds, and mammals using specific primers to identify blood news from these taxa, but they cannot determine if the mosquito prefers to feed on a reptile or a mouse. And they also find a bird avoidance that was quite surprising, citing the authors, because they said that Aedes inter-windows has been observed harassing nests of birds to the point that the bird has to abandon the eggs and the nest. So, as acknowledgement, I want to thank Dr. Patricia Parker for letting me in her lab, the PhD candidate, Samoa Figao, that has been like my mentor in the lab, Rosana Maguiña, for making EcoRepu, Patricia Mendoza, other member of EcoRepu, all the members of the Parker lab, and also the St. Louis Zoo, because I've been doing an internship and going twice a week to the animal behavior lab in the St. Louis. Thank you.
So yes. Can we use to ultrasound the plasmodium inside the mosquitoes? Are they like similar? What is there anything special about that?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
So you show a map and you have like different regions, right?
Yes.
The areas. And your sample, the infected mosquito sample, were only in two regions.
The nine positives that I got.
Yes. Are these regions special somehow?
This part of the of identifying the site of that they were collected with Samoa, the PhD candidate, she was kind of surprised because they were near the coast of the island, but we didn't actually discuss why was it. So the following point, part of this is to sequence them and see if we actually have this one. Mm-hmm.
If you originally had control your water, where the control studies might be.
If we get plasmodium positive via PCR, we have to screen them with a microscopy using the blood smear to identify the stage of the parasite. Because the gametocyte stage does not be found.
No, I mean, in terms of avoiding, like what happened in Hawaii, with the seeing of this, how do you control that?
We then have to figure out the blood feeding preference of the mosquitoes to take measurements in each of the types, but I'm not quite sure the exact procedure.
Do you know if some birds are resistant?
Not so sure. I know that what I've read in some papers is that some like birds are more mobile, so they tend to avoid more mosquitoes than, let's say, a vertebrate that goes to sleep and the mosquitoes start being active at that point.
Why are you
amplifying the function? A portion of the cytochrome B gene.
You showed yourself that they have no, you were not with amplification of some spectrums or some sample web. I know.
On the PCR?
You showed,
on the gel?
Yeah, you showed a picture in the video, but it wasn't here now. So, for example, in the same. It is under the bottom, for example, there are no bands. I guess from that.
No. In this circle lines in pencil is because when I image the gel on the computer, I can actually see light bands. But when I print it, because this is an image of the printed gel, so I printed the image.
When I run a gel, I can save the picture and.
No, it's saved on the computer. But the computer is outside. I took a picture of the paper because on the paper is where I have like the I write down the ID of the sample. But this one is from a whole mosquito. You can see his abdomen and head of thorax from these mosquitoes.
Like what you're putting out in circles, that means that there is plasmodic positivity?
Potential positives with light guns.
All right. Okay, so.
How likely are you to get false negatives? Like, as if you had a mosquito that wasn't infected with the flies. Like, how efficient is your necessary PCR reaction?
I'm not that sure, but it's really, the only way to say this is not true is if we get a contamination on the negative. Mm-hmm. And if the positive doesn't run.
But it's just the opposite. Like, how are you sure that the negative is also
negative? Yeah. Because people doesn't have to find
nothing. Yeah. Yeah, like from, I mean, your controls look awesome. Like, right, your two controls are fine. But for your samples, I mean, when you see a band, you know it's infected. So that's good. But when you don't see a band, how likely it is that it is indeed like not infected?
I've done
230. No, like the same sample.
Not the same sample. If I get negative, if I get those, I say those four.
Have you thought about trying different kinds of PCR? How do you actually do it? Do you extract the genome and then amplify it, or do you?
Someone's already extracted the DNA of the mosquitoes, and I have the samples already.
But your DNA, there's actually DNA in this world kind of PCR, but it is. You just have the DNA and then the PCR and check what's happening there. You don't check the DNA first before you run PCR?
I don't really.
You should. Because we have you should know the concentration of your
temperature.
Yes, but I know. Different concentration, which tests our results. And I usually test not just once, twice.
Yeah.
Maybe it was the component of your PCR data and not your results.
And sometimes you could have too much genome of DNA and that induces the PCR reaction. So you need to try at least 1, 1, 1, 10, 1, 1.
Yes. I think that is part of the optimization.
But then you might be missing some positive results just because you are not testing the amount of DNA. Or there's a
Mari does the part of the bird in Samoa on the mosquitoes. They've done the optimization of these reactions, testing different variables, and they were not getting any.
Still
give a try. Thank you.
I'm going to go to the next one.
I was working with Alfred and Max, and the PhD candidate student, Mohamed and company. So it's quite important to know that the last night, over 1 million people around the world went to sleep without any electricity. This is why many governments are trying to rely more on the nuclear energy around the world. So today we have almost like 440 nuclear power reactors. Over 65 nuclear reactors are under construction. And in the next 15 years, China can build 60 nuclear reactors, and USA can build almost 5 new nuclear power reactors. This is quite important because this is not the only purpose for the nuclear reactors. I mean, to generate electricity when we take the energy release on the reaction that occurs in a nuclear reactor. In the case of McMaster nuclear reactor, this is a research commercial reactor. This nuclear reactor basically is the second producer of iodine around the world, which means that they produce radioisotopes. These are for, I mean, are used for medical purposes, like in the case of the iodine is used for the cancer treatment. So this is the problem here, the issue that we have in the nuclear reactor and the master is that we, in order to increase the production of iodine, which means we need to increase the power energy of our reactor. And we cannot do that. Why? Because we don't have right now a basic criteria or basic steps to in order to optimize the operation that we have in the nuclear reactor today. And trying to improve the operation inside the reactor core, we need these kind of computational tools that I've used in this internship that I'll explain later. But the problem is that in the last years that was used for this analysis to analyze the efficiency of the reactor core was what we call the binding safety analysis. This analysis just take the worst cases scenario on the reactor core, but eventually you wouldn't know about what will happen in the future if these cases will be valid for the operation of the reactor core. This will happen, for example, in the Fukushima accident. When they designed the reactor core, they expected that after an earthquake, it would be like a tsunami of 6 meters in height. what happened is that after the earthquake of 2011, that tsunami was like in 10 meters. I mean, they didn't expect that. They assumed some hate for the tsunami, but what happened as a fact was that they didn't expect this situation. And in order to do that, in parallel with the operation that we get in the any graphic report, it's what we call the computational tools. We need this in order to increase the efficiency of the operation inside of any graphic report. So in the case of Monster Raptor, in 1999, the International Atomic Energy Agency regulates the amount of uranium, I mean, for every raptor research. And this is why they regulate it in terms of, okay, you have to reduce the amount of uranium that you have. So from 1999 to 2007, at Monster Raptor, they reduced the amount of uranium in the nuclear raptor. Because there was no difference between how can we get more efficiency for the operations, how can we get a better better criteria to increase the operation inside the nuclear reactor. And after this reduction, they didn't know anything about the actual amount of uranium. It's quite important. You know anything about any amount of element that is made of what we have in the reactor core. So in order to increase the power, because we want that, in order to increase the production of ironite, we have to know what is the actual amount of uranium that we have today in the nuclear rods that was made earlier. Before we get into details, we have to know about what happened inside the reactor. The main reaction is the fission reaction, which is just when you have a source of neutrons that is outside the reactor core, this slowly to travel through space, get inside the reactor core, and eventually this slow neutron interact with the uranium amplifier, which is the main element that takes part of the fission reaction. Which is the main element of the nuclear rod. Okay, so this interaction creates this splitting of the heavy nuclei into other heavy nuclei and what we call the fast nuclei, the fast neutron. This fast neutron travels through the reactor core, but we need that this fast neutron slow down. This is why we have this important element that is the water. The water minimizes the energy of this fast neutron in order to generate more fission reactions, as you can see in the video. More interaction between the slow neutron and the reactor to get more energy. But the situation that, okay, we can generate fission reaction, but we want to control it. I mean, we don't want any accident or explosion inside the reactor core. The control rod is a neutron absorber. The control rod is used to absorb, as you say, the neutrons in order to control the fission reaction in the reactor. It's like a switch. I mean, if you insert all the control rod, you turn off your reactor core. When you take out almost all the control rod, you initiate the fission reaction. This is quite important. Not only, I mean, how can we know it's a better way to move the control rod, but just it's quite important to know the movement of the nuclear rods that we call the shuttle. The shuttle is just the chain of position of the nuclear rods. And we can see the image. We have a scheme of the nuclear rods. Each square represents this random 35, as you can take it like that. And this is a plain shuttle, okay? This is like they want to change from this position to this position. Why? Because if you get static, the position of the nuclear rods, I mean, you will burn all your fuel, and eventually you will not get more energy for a couple of period of time that you have. So this is quite important to know how can we have a criteria to change the position of the nuclear rods. But for that, to know how we compare criteria, we must not know the field metric, which means what is the actual amount of uranium anode profiles. We are in this project, and we work this focus in this part to analyze from the simulation that we call the core cold simulation, and in terms of how can we improve the reactor core efficiency. So the main point is to know how can we simulate the master of the reactor core in order to optimize the processes that are happening inside the master nuclear reactor. So basically, we have used the OSCAR 4 program, which is a code system designed and developed by NEXA Institute. This is a South Africa institute that focuses on nuclear reactors. And how can we compute this kind of problems? And here is just another figure from the reactor core. I want you to focus on this duration, because in each block is the nuclear rod. As I told you about the control rods, the switch of the reactor core are the pin blocks and the orange one. And another important element is the graphite. The frame, but it was focused on the model of this element because it's quite important given that it reflects the neutrons. I mean, if we want to keep the neutrons inside more time inside the reactor core, this is why we get we have this graphite here. This is how this is the setup of the reactor core today. And according to that, we have to model this fire element inside, and you can see in the middle of this circle, we put here a target, we can put xenon, and when we turn on our reactor core, we produce the ion that we are want to obtain. So the problem is that we cannot get the same geometry because it's quite hard to analyze this way. So this is why, according to the theory that is behind us, we just focus on the area. Okay, the gray curve is the target. I mean, sorry, is the graphite. So we are focused that the area of the model element graphite must be fitted with the actual area of the graphite that we have in the reactor. I'm very interested in this part because with this element we can model this part of the nuclear reactor, and according with this configuration that we have taken from the February 2007, we have modeled just one month in 2007 from February to March. So we are trying to analyze what is the amount of uranium that was burned in this animal. So in this case, you also have the same picture. It is the graphite, you have the pure rods, you have the control rods, the switch of the reactor core. Eventually, you can put here beryllium to test it, and you have empty space. When you have, I mean, you can put also some samples inside this each block. According with that, it's quite important to get into details about according with the theory of reactors, we expect that in the middle we burn more uranium than in the boundaries. We also expect, as I mentioned, that we get more burned uranium in this side, the left side, and the right side, because of the presence of the graphite on this side. And actually, we want to know how the neutrons interact with the nuclear rods and these kind of elements. So the results were like we are trying to verify the burned uranium, and in this way we have the same image. We obtain intensity. I mean, we obtain a ton of tables, so we can get the intensity of the the graph intensity, which means that the yellow one is that more burn brine we get, and the blue one is like we get less burn brine, zero. So according with what we expected, in the middle we burn more uranium than in the boundaries. You can see here a minimum in zero running grams because it's the same spot like that. You don't have, I mean, we, in this model we don't have anything here. As well as this spot and this spot. And the problem is that according with that we can see, I mean, some regions that we can optimize and to put the samples that we are looking for. When we are compute the whole system, the whole reactor core, in this 1 month cycle that we burn the uranium 25, we just could burn like 51 grams. But this is not the only important element that we are interested. We are also interested in the plutonium 49, which is basically a monitoring of the plutonium production. The plutonium could be used for military purposes. And this is what the International Atomic Energy Agency is very careful about it. So when we are trying to simulate just this 1 month, we get 2 grams of plutonium, which is not, I mean, it's very, very, very few European one. But the case is that this simulation, I mean, how much of plutonium they create just 1 month, wasn't done in the last year, and according we get the same intensity plot, which means again that in the middle we produce more plutonium than in the boundaries. Okay, so it can tell us about that we can change some of the nuclear rods in order to optimize. How can we move this region's energy to the spots that we went to put the samples for the production of the iron and basically. And in summary, it was possible to model the mass transfer reactor. And at the beginning, it was carved in the part of the graphite element, but it could be possible in order to know what are the effects of this graphite in terms of the interaction of the neutrons with the nuclear reactors. The simulation can give us an estimate of the amount of nuclear elements in general. We just not focus on uranium and plutonium. Just we could simulate 1 month, we need to simulate more months in order to really know what is the actual amount of plutonium, the uranium, sorry. The problem is that the period of time is like 10 years, so it's quite hard right now to model the total period of time. There is no correct criteria, as I told you, I mean, at the change in the position, of the control rules, of the nuclear rods, is because there was not a simulation that we are currently doing. And this is quite important for the future direction because while we have a criteria that comes from the simulation to know how can we move better the control or how can we move better the nuclear rods, we can optimize our reactor core, and it means like we can create more iron in terms of how can we increase the power of our reactor and master university. I really want to thank first to the Red Bull program for this opportunity to this awesome internship, and my home university, the Catholic University, for the financial support. My advisor, Adrian Bikes, and my friend actually, and a music guided student, Mohamed Hafani, to help me a lot. And my rep mentor, SMD, who support me a lot in this period of time. So, thank you. Thank you so much. Congratulations.
Yeah, I have some questions. The first one is just to be sure, even when you were able to simulate the reaction to the reactor, in this stage, you're not capable to have an analytical way to optimize the reaction inside the reactor.
Yeah, that's true.
Then I'm like just trying in different ways. But is there a pathway to go to reach that goal and to find the
analytical way?
Yeah, and go to the reactor.
I mean, analytically, it's. I cannot say impossible, but it's very hard because this whole theory about how the neutrons move in the reactor core, because you take into account how they interact, is we call a transport theory, and it's very hard to solve just the equation. And when we try to solve in this program, we reduce the theory. We're used to diffusion theory, which is simpler. So this program what it's trying to do is to compute but as first approximation. It's not like we are totally sure that it is the real amount of uranium, and in terms of that we can generate some errors, you know, to optimize the reactor core. But this is not the only problem. I mean, there are other different ones. But there are other uncertainties, as you say, just about the nuclear physics, which is very hard.
And in the reactors, the reaction happens in chains.
Yeah.
So where the chain starts in your geometry?
In my geometry?
Yeah, where everything starts.
Okay, in the simulation, you mean?
Yeah, I mean, you need like a first neutron that.
Yeah. Well, the thing is that we focus in the period of time when it's burning.
Okay.
So when the first interaction that you can say is what we call the flux. Okay. But this is just the first chain reaction that you can get. We are focused on after we control the fission reaction. Because at the beginning, you cannot say, okay, we control the fission reaction. We just start and according with how it's going on in the interaction with the neutrons and the nuclear rods. Moving in the control rods, we get this controlling state of the reactor. And after at the beginning of this state, we start to.
So we start simulating when the reactor is already stabilized.
Yeah, we start.
Okay, yes.
Yes, because before that we don't. I mean, we cannot take this information very very precisely. Okay.
So we're going to have a break of 20 minutes and we'll be back.
Ya, si puedes tener un minutito de atención, bueno, como ustedes saben, este año ya no soy directora de Recu, fue un honor trabajar con todos ustedes y voy a seguir trabajando con en pro del programa, ya no la cabeza porque tienen a Kenny, tienen a Edson, tienen a Paola, que son súper, súper buenos líderes. Y les quería comentar un poquito del Club de Conciencia Perú, que es un proyecto que ahora está llevando junto con otras personas de Estados Unidos y Perú, incluido él. Este proyecto es. Vamos a llevar gente que está estudiando en Estados Unidos, el PhD, haciendo un poco o profesores, a Perú para que den un workshop de una semana. Ya terminamos con las postulaciones de instructores internacionales, es decir, los estudiantes, los profesores que están acá en Estados Unidos y ahora en Perú, y recibimos 400 postulaciones.
¡Wow!
Sí.
Estamos mandando los mensajes como si no tuviese nadie.
¿Qué? No, entonces, la idea básicamente es que este año vamos a empezar en tres diferentes sedes. En la UTP, en la UNI y en la Cayetano Heredia, vamos a llevar 10 clubes, de repente son 12 porque hay muy, muy buenos, y vamos a capacitar a 250 alumnos. La idea es que de aquí a 2-3 años nos vayamos a Arequipa, a Cusco, a Tumbes, a Piura, y capacitemos más o menos a 1000 estudiantes por año. Entonces, les quería avisar para que eventualmente participen de esto. Hay mucha gente de red involucrada. Y es una iniciativa bonita para poder devolver un poco más a nuestro país que tanto nos ha dado, ¿no? O sea, para que tenga un ejemplo, uno de los clubes que se ha propuesto y que ojalá que lo traigamos es un profesor de una academia militar de Estados Unidos que vaya a Perú con un dron para mapear visualmente las áreas que tienen alto riesgo en caso de un fenómeno natural, ¿no? Es súper, súper hot ahorita con todo lo que está pasando en Perú. Y bueno, como para hacer un poquito más de marketing, decidimos hacer un sorteo de. Estamos haciendo un sorteo de Giant Microbes. Entonces, estamos sorteando 6 cajitas y prometí que lo iba a hacer durante el break del Recu Seminar. Así que necesito 5 voluntarios para que saquen un papelito.
No,
ya acabó, era el Facebook. Ya, vamos, vea, el primer cajita de Giant Macro que vamos a sortear es Body 6. Son buenas, son
buenas.
Entonces, la ganadora es Luisa López.
¡Bravo!
Y ahora vamos a sortear Organ Cells. Por favor, necesitamos otro voluntario. ¡Vamos, vamos! A ver, bueno, ya. Luz Castillo, Organ Cells.
¡Bravo!
El siguiente es Exotic Vacations. Exotic Vacations. Esa cajita tiene malaria, tiene dengue. Es bien chévere. Alessandra Urrutia.
¡Bravo!
Ya. Después vamos a sortear Vampire Snack. Rocío del Carmen.
Yeah.
¡Bravo! Ahora, son 6 cajitas. Sick Day. En esta cajita está el flujo. ¿Alguien sabía de chile?
Ya.
Josefina Jiménez. Ya, el último. Biohazards.
¿Alguien lo que
Victor. Run, Victor, run.
Eleonora Córdoba. ¡Bravo! Gracias por el espacio. Bueno, no sé nada, ¿eh, chicos? De ahí vamos a postear en Facebook quiénes ganaron.
Thank you everyone for staying with us up until the end. So now we're going to start the last section of today's Redwood seminar. And the first speaker of the final section is Claudia Palisueño. She is from La Pontificia Universidad Católica del Perú. And she did her research internship at General Atomics in sunny California. So she will be joining us remotely because she's already in Peru. Let's give her a warm welcome.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for the introduction, Paola. So, I did an internship in National Fusion Facility, which is part of General Atomics. And my research was the reactor processing and analysis of nova 7-inch bagged gyrotron colorimetry and polarity for mass measurements, which sounds frightening, but I could I will talk about what is D3D for those who doesn't know. Then I will talk about how do we heat plasma, and at the end I will explain my research. What was it about, how the data I have was processed, and our results. So, what is D3D? D3D is a fusion reactor facility, which means that in the D3D building, we make fusion happen. And what is a fusion is that reaction, we have two atoms that we put together in order to get a large atom. After doing this process, there is some energy that is released. The easiest way to produce fusion is to choose hydrogen atoms. So here I have two helium and tritium, which is just heavy hydrogen. And we put them together in order to have helium and neutron as a product. So, I mentioned the helium and tritium. Can the other atoms? Yeah. But in this case, we use helium and tritium. So we have here atoms, which we can say that actually we have a gas because we have a lot of them. And what happens when we heat a gas? When we heat a gas, we increase their available energy and we break the atom apart, so we have ion and electron. And we get plasma. To make fusion happen, we need very high temperatures in order to ionize the atom. And for example, most of us remember what is ionization, just when we add some energy, create a new electrons and have ion electrons. It's a confinement, so we need to confine these ions and electrons long enough in order to produce a helium. So naturally, as we have positive charges and then the charges to repel each other. So we need magnets to tell, hey, go away, where you are. In the sun, we make wind fusion too, but the sun has a lot of gravity, so the sun has gravity to hold us together. In, on Earth, we have magnets and we use them. So what I want you to remember here is that we need very high temperature. And how do we heat plasma? How we can heat plasma enough energy to produce fusion long enough for us to use as a source of energy? Well, what we have to heat the plasma is ETH. ETH means electron cycle overheating, which also sounds frightening, but it's not really important what the name means right now. What I want you to know how is the mechanism of ETH, which is really similar to the one your microwave oven has. For example, you have a microwave oven at home and you want to heat a pizza. So, well, you don't know that inside the microwave there is a device called magnetron. This magnetron produces microwaves, electromagnetic waves, and of course you need some form of eye to guide these of microwaves into your pizza. So we put something called a waveguide. And that waveguide then is produced by the magnetron into your pizza. And all of that is inside your microwave. Microwaves make good molecules. So this energy goes into the chamber inside the microwave to make your food, the molecules could vibrate, so start speeding up. Something similar we have D3D. Here is a picture of the inside of the reactor. Here we have plasma and here we have plasma. So the plasma will be equivalent to the heat we want to heat the plasma. And of course, we need a waveguide. So the waveguide is a wave. And when at magnetron, here you see we do not drop it. It is something very similar that has the name of gyrotron. So the gyrotron will be the magnetron in the mind of. We use gyrotron in ETH, and that's important. We have right now operational. And another thing that I want to say is that I would use frequency RF, which is private frequency, and it's the same thing as the microwaves. So, for example, the radio is microwaves, and we usually refer to those waves as private frequency or RF. My research. What was it about? What was my research in the National Fusion Facility? Well, my research was focused on the gyrotron collector. So, you have already the gyrotron, which is and the gyrotron produced RF in order to heat the plasma, as I said already. This is the real gyrotron, and in this device, there is something called oxygen, which is a cylinder called collector. My research as focused on this specific part of the jar. So, what happens? As you turn on your microwave oven, there is energy going into your food. But when you turn the gyrotron on, not all the energy that you produce is going inside the plasma. Some of the energy goes up and it's lost everything. And you need something to collect that everything. So that's why we collect your fish. So this energy comes in a form of an electromagnetic wave for matter, and it looks something like this. It's like a routine of electrons going up. First, as you have some magnets here, it's really narrow the beam, but as it continues free, it can start spreading out. So it goes up, and here is the collector of the electrons. So if this beam arrives near the bottom of the collector, it's really dead. But if it continues up, it will start spreading out. So the energy that the collector will get is then there. And up there will be more effect than down because it's less dead. You can adjust the ETH, where do you want things to arrive. So you can get to make a bit go up and down or going like this. Off and on. So you protect that electron apart because you are producing a lot of energy. The gyroton produces 1 megawatt, and while your microwave oven produces 1 kilowatt. So it's a lot of energy. So, of course, this cylinder, this collector, has a power limit that can handle. And that number is 500 watts per square. What does it mean? You have your collector, so the cylinder, and let's okay. So we will have an example. In 1 centimeter of this collector, in the star space of the collector, can get just 500 watts. The question is, after some failures at an ETH or past barrier, he asked the question, are we operating safe zone? In order to answer that question, there are some sensors that are silver squares around the collector they use here, the optical arc, that are sensitive to the variation temperature. So, the position that was implemented in order to measure how much energy each collector was giving and if you're operating under each limit. Well, I told you about the project. My project was to process the data. I felt the information I grew in order if we continue operating under the limits that we've been operating so far, or we change something. So I want you to talk about right now about how the data was processed. Well, I took measurements in 2 different SNIs. First, we changed the pulse. What does this mean? You can put your pizza in your microwave oven for 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 1 minute, etc. It's the same. We turn on the gyroton. And we did 0.5 seconds, 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds. Other way to heat your pizza is if you turn on the microwave oven and then turn it off, and then turn it on, and then turn it off, and so on and so on. So we need to say that is called different duty cycle. So you turn on, off, on, off, on, off. Different circumstances that I wanted to know is to how the collector was behaving and if it could handle that energy. So, how I processed all the data I got from these 2 different scenarios? Well, the data was from the RTCs, and some of them were not operational. And in order to get all the information, I then had to do some interpolation. Then I wrote a code in Water Mathematica 11 and Python in order to signal processing and also to interpolate what RTC I had. To do the interpolation of what RTC, I used the surrounding, the neighborhood of the missing RTC to estimate how much would be the temperature. And then I use a formula. So the important thing to know in this formula is that power density of every RTD is proportional to the temperature that is measured in this RTD in the larger sensors of temperature. For example, let's see, you turn on your microwave oven and you put it just 2 seconds and then you turn it off. This sensor, this RTD that is located in a 64 position, let's say, will start sensing this variation in temperature. And you can see here how the temperature is increasing and it's a point of 31.5°. This RTD I chose because it was a hot pop in a double second for max. This is a hot temperature pop. So this is how the power density is distributed around the cylinder I showed you. In this case, the 3 second pulse, we are working under the dangerous number that is 500 watts per square centimeter. So we are okay. Now, I will show you the complete results, by the way. First, when we walk through the pulse width, so we just on and turn off and that's it, the data I got is that for Delta 7, operating with short pulses is really dangerous. It's over the limit because it's over 500 watts per square centimeter here. For Chewbacca, for 1, 2, and 3 seconds, they were all over the limit. So we're over the danger zone. Now, for variable duty cycle, which is turn on, turn off, for Delta 7, all of them are in the danger zone, but especially when you turn on and you turn off your microwave oven really fast. So when we start sending the gyrotron on, off to different apps, we are at the limit that we have right now. And for Chewbacca, I put a map in order to visualize what happens. Here, the collector has a hot spot for a 10% cycle, which is over 500 per centimeter, as you can see here. So, as a summary, I present the data from the Venetian Gas Gyrotron, and I did signal processing and decimalizing in order to find out if they were working under the limit or over the limit. Of course, our results show that the operations of low duty cycle, which is turn on, turn off, really fast, results in the electric power density higher than the limit that we have, which is 500 watts per centimeter. And that's a usual work to include taking additional data in order to define how fast that supercoil works. As I said, you can decide where the speed will arrive, up or down the cylinder of the collector. So you can make have more time up, so being so spread that the impact in the force of the collector is less than if you put it down for each split end. So there's the actual where is the best speed that we can have in order to protect the gyrotron collector and protect them for rain or damage cold device. So finally, I want to thank everyone for the great opportunity and for this internship, and for my mentor Humberto Arlanda and all of the mechanics and mentor tools and network team again. I learned a lot there, not only but also other skills. Are really incredible. I want to thank Jose Luis and Drew because they were built for it, and every time I have questions, it will just tell me everything about it. I look around all the facilities in order to know what is happening or why it works like that in the future. And finally, for financial support, I want to thank the Department of Energy, the DOE, the United States of America, because for what it is possible. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Claudia. So now we have some questions here.
Yeah, Claudia, can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Yeah, I can explain it a little bit, but because of the audio, I have problem understanding. But what happens when you have overflow in your collector, I mean, when you have more than 500 watts per centimeter squared? Is that dangerous or somehow?
That's
the question.
So if I understood well, what happens if we go over the limit?
Yeah, what happens?
Okay, so this project was motivated because for a specific collector, it broke apart because of the line around. The collector broke and they were asking, why did it happen? I mean, if we were working under the limit, the limit then was 700 watts per square centimeter, well, higher than now it is. So they use a microscope in order to see the collector and to see what causes the break. And they saw that as you raise a lot of the temperature of the collector because you're sending a lot of energy, then you cool it down. And that increasing the temperature and that cooling down so fast forms some crystals inside a collector. A collector is made by copper. It uses copper. So there were some crystals formed from the collector, and they were crystals start breaking inside what the collector. So there's some cracks in the collector. And in some case, it just has made a hole, and all the pulling iron that passed around the collector when inside the collector and also inside the hole. So now Lion is dead, so Jared is dead. And they said, if you look at the leak, why this happened? So they sent it back to the manufacturer and they say, operation, so now we'll lower you the limit, the operational limit, now 500 watts per square centimeter. So it's not that if we go over that limit, if the collector will break, but it prevents the collector from breaking because you're using it every day. So there is a concept of fatigue. If you continue using every day, a lot of time, material, there will reach an area that will start killing a team, will start breaking apart or not work well. So that's why now we're really concerned about how much energy we are putting in a surface or a collector. Thank you.
Yeah, and another question that I got is you're storing this energy because you want to use it. So, how do you take the energy from the collector?
No, you don't use the collector. You actually, let's say if I have here a, give me a second. So, in this, can you see my screen?
Yeah.
So, this is the gyrometer. Okay, so you set the micro here and then go this way up to the end of her time. So you have to go this way. Okay, so that's the way of the way of that. The collector is there because not all the energy you produce down here goes to this waveguide. So you have to put something that needs energy that you don't use. It's like a way to dispose of something like that. And you put that, if you put this collector in the top, here by copper, so it can get all the energy does not go to the back.
Okay, I got it. Thanks.
Well, thank you, Claudia, and let's thank her. Okay, so well, our next speaker will also join us remotely. She'll be joining us soon. Okay. Okay. So I'll introduce our next speaker, Gabriel. Gabriel Sevillano, he is from Universidad Peruana Cayetano Heredia, or Cayetano Heredia University, which is my home university as well. And he is joining us from Germany, from KDT's Redpool Research Internship at Ruhr University. And we are ready for you, Gabo. So, whenever you are ready.
Not yet, no. Good evening, everyone. Okay. Hey, I will be talking about the research project in which I participated these last 3 months on amber receptors and colloids. I worked alongside Tobias Strasdijk, who is a PhD student under the supervision of Professor Michael Hoffman of the Department of Biochemistry 1, Center of Biochemistry at the Bochum University of Bochum in Germany. So I will share my screen now. Okay. Okay. So first, I want to show you an electron micrograph of the synapse. So what synapse is a structure where neurons communicate. So this is a unidirectional communication. This is a drawing also of the synapse. Here we can see the parts. There is a presynaptic neuron which contains these little bugs called vesicles. Inside these vesicles, there are molecules called neurotransmitters, and the neuron is neurotransmitters to communicate with each other. So the presynaptic neuron will release these neurotransmitters into the synaptic cleft, which is a space between the neurons, and the postsynaptic neuron has on its surface things called receptors, which will recognize and bind to the neurotransmitters. And in this way, the postsynaptic neuron will respond accordingly to the signal. So one very important neurotransmitter is called glutamine. Why is it important? Well, because it's implicated in muscle movement, in thought process, and in memory. One also important type of glutamine receptor is called the AMPA receptor. And AMPA receptors are tetrameric, iotropic receptors. Tetrameric means that they are assembled by force units. Here we can see the crystal structure of the AMPA receptor. Its color represents one different subunit, and it means that they are a channel. So if they bind to glutamine, they open, allowing ions to come into the cell, in this case, soluble cations. So this is the structure of one subunit of glutamine AMPA receptor. The most important parts are ligand binding domain in purple, where the glutamine will bind, and the tetrameric domain, which is the core region that will open when glutamine binds. So there are four types of subunits, A1, A2, A3, and A4, and the most important and infused ones are A1 and A2. So these upper receptors do not work alone. There's a family of proteins known as TARPs, or transmembrane upregulated proteins, which regulate the activity of AMPA receptor. And there are so far two types of TARPs has been described, classical TARPs, participating in the translocation of AMPA receptor towards the membrane of the postsynaptic neuron and also regulating their activity from there. And two TARPs only regulate the AMPA receptor function. These TARPs belong to a bigger superfamily of proteins known as transthyretins, which are proteins that have four transmembrane domains. So we can see here the structure of the TARP, four transmembrane domains and two associated loops. Another family of proteins which belongs to the transthyretin family are the clonins. So clonins have many similarities with TARPs in six-anion structure. In sequence, we have a 23% homology, which is very high for proteins. And in a study on 2005, they showed that the TARP GAP2, which was the first TARP discovered as extensively studied, the TARP in vitro mediate also cell addition, similar to in one. So this is explained due to the similarities in structure. So if we have these similarities, and if the TARP GAP2 in some sense, in some positions, can mediate that cell addition, then can clonins also interact and regulate other receptor activity? So this is some data from a postdoctoral thesis in 2015, that's where I was working. I want you to focus on the highlighted parts. We have a co-expression of homomeres of BlueA1 with three different clonings, including 11, 20, and 24, and also co-expression of homomeres of BlueA2, same clonings. There are also two variants of BlueA2, the Q and R, but they are very important right now. And what we can see that when co-expressing clonings 20, 24, homomeres of BlueA1 show a positive, there's a positive modulation of the activity of these receptors. And also, clonin 24, when co-expressed in BlueA2R, there's also a positive modulation. But they just want to see the heterogeneity between these two subunits. But can see here the results for the heteromeres were not significant or were not inclusive. So we here the common species BlueA2R and BlueA1 both have people efficient when compared with blood 24, but we don't see the same effect in the heteromere. So also another experiment was done, a pet experiment which is used to check for interaction between things, and also those results were inconclusive. So the main problem in the expression system was that there were three proteins that were interacting or not, had to interact to HR, A1, and the clonin. So in this expression system, we homomeres of A2, homomeres of A1, and heteromeres in proportions, and all these combinations may or may not interact with the development of all different proportions. So when we are measuring the activity of the receptors in the system, all these factors, that might be a problem. So that may be possible. So that was through the aim of project expecting. We wanted to fuse the 11 to 24 to the receptors unit BlueA1. Better characterized in A1 and 2 heteromeres. So if we had a fusion protein, A1 and a clonin, then we only had, then we would only have two proteins in this expression system, which would be easier to characterize. To do this, first clone the clonin and the BlueA1 subunit into a vector, and through in vitro transcription, we obtain protein RNA. We use the expression system of these oocytes, which are the X. This is a very popular system because these are very detailed, about 2 meters in diameter. They are very easy to manipulate and very easy to inject with coding RNA. So that's what we did. We inject the coding RNA for our fusion protein, and after 4 days we had expression system with the oocyte expressed our visual processing in the membrane. To measure the receptor activity, we use this setup. It's a two electron voltage budget cube that cut our oocyte and insert two electrodes. One electrode will measure, will sense the membrane potential, and the other electrode will maintain it constant, will keep it constant. So if we have our receptor being expressed in the membrane of the oocyte and we add glutamate to the oocyte, then the receptors will bind to glutamate, they will open, and so it will enter into the cell. So it will depolarize. But this electrode will keep the cell from depolarizing, will keep the membrane potential constant by applying a current. And what measure is the current? So we are indirectly measuring the activity of every receptor in the surface of the oocyte. So for the results, well, first the results for 3011, we used four experimental groups. The first group was the receptor alone, the white receptor. The second group was a co-expression between the white receptor and the glowing co-expression. The third group is a co-expression between the Wi-Fi receptor and the fusion, and our fourth group was only the fusion. So we can see that when we apply glutamate, the activity of the receptor is greatly reduced. We also decided to co-apply TCA, which is the sensitization inhibitor. So this molecule basically forces the alpha receptor to remain open for a much more longer time, and we will measure even higher current. So when we co-apply TCM, there's no significant difference between all these four groups. So this reduction in the activity of the receptor may not be because of problems in the fault or in the translocation towards the membrane, because when we apply TCM, we see that there is a fact being expressed and working. We see a similar term going check in the fusion protein dose of the use current. And we also got it before proposing that when we spread receptor going support, see an increase in the receptor function when we apply also PC. We also decided to use a mutant called LY mutant, which is a non desensitizing mutant. So this the receptor that has at least one subunit that this LY mutant will not desensitize instead to get applied to him. So again, we have four experimental groups, a mutant only group, a popular mutant. Our second group was a co-expression between the mutant and the glowing. The third group was a co-expression between the wild-type receptor and the mutant. And our fourth group was a co-expression between the mutant and our fusion protein. So, again, when we apply glutamate, we do not see a significant difference between these four groups because the receptor is always desensitized. It's immune to the sensitization. But when we apply TCM, we see an increase of the groups, which is due to homomeres of white type or fusion protein also assembled. So that explains this increase in the current. We see that we see a similar pattern also for clone 20, an increase in the current for these two groups due to homomeres of white type and fusion protein. And for clone 24, again, we see an increase in the current in these last two groups, but we also see an increase of the current when we co-express the LY mutant and clone 24. So these results might suggest that either clone 24 is regulating the receptor in a way that's independent of the sensitization, or clone 24 might somehow be involved or might hold a better translocation of the receptor to the membrane. So this increase in the receptor function that we see here might, there's maybe due to more receptor in the membrane. So for our conclusions and final remarks, first, the function of the goal is to be to reduce this function, so it did not work that well. But the function of the receptor was recovered when we the sedation inhibitor, or when we co-express that with L1-mutant. So we know that the receptor is expressed and is working. And this data shows that the co-expression with selection before increases the receptor function, and as I mentioned before, it might be due to regulation selection before of the receptor, or that it promotes translocation of the receptor towards the membrane. So thank you everyone, thank you for your time. I just want to thank my host lab, these are the members, especially Professor Michael Holman and Tobias Strassai, with my work library. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Fabien. That was an awesome presentation. And now, please, anyone has questions? Yes, there's a question.
Hi, so the question I have is about the plugins that you use. Use 3, 11, 20, and 24. Are any of these plugins actually expressed in the neurons? Why do you narrow down those three?
Yes, actually, these three neurons are only expressed in the brain. So there are about 30, 35 different types of plugins. And about a third of them were we found them on mice brain. So these three colleagues were selected from them. So these three are being expressed in the brain. We don't know in which cellular type or in what part of the brain, but they are being expressed.
Do you know if they are actually being co-expressed with AMPA receptors, or they're expressed in the glutamate neurons? Because it can be expressed in the brain, that doesn't mean that they are in the same system or the same neuron.
So far, do not know if they are also being co-expressed with AMPA receptors. That's also it's inside of the steps to come. So this was these are only the first steps in the whole charm clothing project.
Thank you.
Anyone has any more questions for Gabo?
No? Thank
you. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Well, our last but not least, our next speaker, Bea. She, Beatriz Garcia, she's from Cayetano Heredia University as well. And she did her internship at NYU, New York University, nearby here. So please, everyone, let's welcome our awesome next speaker, Beatriz.
Thank you. Thank you, Pablo. Hello, everyone. My name is Beatriz Garcia. I am currently working in the Lehman Lab in New York University, and I am part of Revue Biology. And today I'm going to talk to you about the project that I've been working on in the last 2 months that is called Decoding Signaling Networks, Regulating Drosophila Primordial Gel Migration. I would like to start with the idea that biological processes are very dynamic. They usually are related to changes in cell morphology, and this is usually because of cytoskeleton rearrangements. Here we have two examples of that. This one is, like I could say, cell migration. This is a mouse fibroblast, and it has protrusions that help it move. And these are two HeLa cells undergoing cell division, and exactly inside of Kinesis, which is necessary for us when the $2 sales are individualized. And in during development, salary arrangement is going to lead to many, many, many things. For example, it's going to lead to the formation of the three germinal layers. We have the mesoderm that is going to differentiate later on to muscle, to kidney and red blood cells and many others. We have the endoderm, who's going to be part of the lung, the thyroid, the pancreas, and the ectoderm, who's going to be part of the skin, brain tissue, pigment cells, many others. And we also have the germ cells. In the Lincoln lab, we work with Drosophila, which are fruit flies. And why exactly we work with them? For many, many reasons. First of all, they are very cost effective. They have a short lifespan, so we are able to work with more generations in a shorter time. They have a less complex genome, so they don't have duplications of genes. And they only have 4 chromosomes, which makes genetic experiments and studies very easy. And besides all that, the knowledge about fly biology is really huge. So we have many strategies and technologies and resources that we can use to make any experiment we want. And, you know, that's a lot of advantages. But even more, 75% of human diseases, disease-causing genes, have homologs in fruit flies. And fruit flies can lead to many medical applications. Okay, so let's go back to development. My lab works in development, in embryonic development on the fruit fly in general. But my project is focused on primordial germ cells. And what are them? They are the precursors of the oocytes and the spermatocytes in the adult fly. So we have here the embryo. Primordial germ cells appear for the first time during stage 5 in the posterior pole, right here in green. Then they are migrating inside the embryo and they are internalized, and during stage 8 they are already inside right next to the midgut and they are individual cells. But at the beginning of stage 9 you can see that the cells have formed some sort of cluster that seems to be united in the center, and by the end of stage 9 they have individualized and they are ready to continue their migration so they can go to the final destination, that is the gonad. So here we have a live video of what is actually happening in the embryo. You can see that at first they work together right here, then they are individualizing, and you can see the individual cells migrating through the leaf gut. So when we saw this video, we realized that the cells were individualizing, and we really are trying to focus on this step. They were forming a cluster, and then they are individual. This is just a bigger representation of what's happening in stage 9. First, we have a rosette, that's how we call the cluster. And we think that the membranes are fused in the middle. And by the end of the stage 9, they're individualized and they're migrating. So what's going on? We think that there's some sort of membrane cutting right here, and there are cell constriction mechanisms going on. So when you think about membrane cutting and cell constriction, you kind of think about a contractile ring. And the contractile ring is regulated by the Rho pathway. Rho is a GTPase that acts on two main proteins. These are ROCK and DIVE. These two proteins are involved in many cell rearrangements, like cytoskeletal rearrangement processes. And this is why the main objective of the study is to study if the proteins involved in the cell constriction are the ones that are acting in the primordial germ cell individualization. And we think that indeed primordial germ cells are using contractile ring mechanisms to individualize. So to test this hypothesis, we are analyzing the Rho pathway. This is a very simplified version of the Rho pathway because it's really, really complex. But these are just the 10 more important for me right now. And we're taking these proteins and we're analyzing their locations using fluorescent tags. And how do we do this? We take the gene of interest and right next to it, we insert a fluorescent protein sequence. So after transcription and translation, you get a fusion protein
that has the fluorescent protein. And you can excite this protein with a certain wavelength, and this is going to emit another wavelength that you can receive, observe, and analyze in a fluorescence microscope. So, it's important to consider that this whole pathway is initiated by TRE1. TRE1 is a transmembrane G protein coupled receptor that is present in the primordial germ cells, and it's very involved in the development, migration of the primordial germ cells, and it also affects the formation of the rosette. Here we have an embryo that has the normal gene TRE1. This is a wild type. And you can see that the rosette is very circular, it has a defined center, it's normal, that's how it's supposed to be. But when the embryo does not have the TRE1 gene, the rosette is very irregular, it doesn't have a shape, and you can't really say where the center is. So we're comparing this our experiments in both genetic backgrounds with a normal rosette and with an abnormal rosette. The results I'm going to present to you today are just of the two downstream effectors of Rho. The first one of them is myosin 2. In the first row, you have a wild type embryo, and in the second one, a TRE1 minus embryo. You see in blue the membrane of the primordial germ cells, in magenta, the active Rho1, in yellow, squash, that is the fruit fly name for myosin 2. And you can see in the wild type embryo that Rho1 is very concentrated in the middle of the rosette, right here, it's the same place. And even if the squash is everywhere because it's part of the cytoskeleton, it's brighter here. But in the TRE1 mutant embryo, you can see that Rho1 is basically everywhere, it's not focused in the middle. And the same thing is happening with squash. The second thing we analyzed was ROCK, which is the Rho kinase. It's right